Hi, good morning. Thank you for inviting me again, and it's good to see you, Mimi.
Good to see you too. So the numbers are actually pretty strong, better than expected. Subscriber growth numbers also decent. Net addition of 43,000 in Q1. Talk to us about what happened in the last 3 months and what you think could happen in the next six for the rest of the year. What's the outlook?
Well, the good news is that we are on a reversal. Last year was tough for everyone. 43,000 net adds doesn't sound like much, but if you take it in the context that this is the only telco who actually registered a total growth in its net adds for the quarter, it is pretty good. This, by the way, brought us to a total of 1.92 million subscribers. So we're seeing good take up from new customers, and while churn levels are elevated, I mean higher than our internal targets, it's still better. And this combination together led to this good result where we have a positive growth in terms of subscribers for the quarter.
Everybody knows this, that the telcos, Converge, PLDT, Globe, were the pandemic darlings. You guys were on a rock and roll mode over the last 3 years because everybody was stay at home. We're all dependent on internet connection, fiber internet in your case. Do you think that the momentum can be sustained this year?
We'd like to characterize it as, hyper growth is gone. We were hit with a double whammy, as we all know, cost of living crisis coming from the Ukraine war and the reopening of the economy. So we feel, though, that the market is still there. The middle class, which is our target, people who can afford 1500 or above, is saturating, but they are replenishing apparently because we're still getting good traction on new ads. But the next wave really would be the segment below that, all the way down to D1, people who cannot really afford, let's say, 1500, but they are about 8 to 9 million strong. And today, largely making do with fixed wireless broadband or even just their mobile phone. So that would be the next wave of growth for us.
And this is through Surf to Sawa, your prepaid fiber internet service.
Yes. Well, actually, Surf to Sawa reaches to the other extreme, no? The Class E, where they are really probably able to afford a certain amount every month, but not on a regular basis. So that's why it's prepaid. And there is something else coming up, in the next few months, which is a more affordable postpaid brand for people who would be in the middle, between the middle class and the e-market, which can only afford prepaid.
All right. I'm very curious. You've been talking about sensitivity of customers to prices, but Converge in general, you guys have not raised prices yet, right?
No, we have not raised our prices. What we have done is, all the way back from 2016, we have incrementally increased the bandwidth allowance. So, for example, our high-end plan now goes all the way to 1 gigabit, although it is a bit expensive relative to Singapore or Hong Kong, where 1 gigabit service is equivalent to the current base plan we have of 1,500 pesos. So, no, we have not increased prices, but we have been continuously improving the value of the offer in terms of the speed.
And no plans to increase moving forward. I mean, in a bid to protect margins and to cushion some of the additional cost inputs. No plans?
There are no plans today. Converge has always been running a very tight ship, pre-Warburg and pre-IPO. We were actually very good at cost control because we're using the latest and greatest technology, fiber, of course, our costs tend to be lower. So, reaching out to the next segments of the market, the Class D and the Class E, our belief is that it will all be accretive in the end. We've already built the network. Today, we cover about 60% of the households or about 16 million homes passed. We have about 6 million ports available to sell, so they're already there. The challenge now for us is to monetize them in the most profitable manner possible.
All right. Before we move on to other matters, I'm very curious, did you ever notice any change in payment behaviors of your clients, especially the postpaid clients? Are people generally paying on time or a little bit later these days? Because delays in payments could be read as indicators of consumer weakness as we head into a slowdown, which will also have impact on your working capital. What are you seeing on the balance sheet?
Well, last year when we reopened, it was really bad. People who could afford to pay 1,500 pesos every month, month on month, suddenly had challenges. You know, their expenses increased, and that was what led to, you know, heavy churn across the industry, not just to Converge. But as I was mentioning earlier, you know, while churn levels are still higher than we want them to be, it has actually come down. It's normalized. So we're seeing payment behaviors going back to normal. We have reinstituted, you know, the previous selling schemes we had, which are a bit stricter than most. So this has led to, you know, the quality of customers on our base being a whole lot better. And as a result, therefore, you know, the payment habits of the customers that we retain are much better than last year.
All right. Churn rate, you mentioned this several times, higher than ideal. What is the churn rate today?
Last quarter we were at about 1.8. Mm-hmm. It's still, you know, well below our expectations. We were bracing for about 2%, but you know, in the past we came from 1.2, so we're not happy with that, and we are doing a lot of things to get it way back to, you know, a more acceptable level to us, which would be about 1.5 or less.
All right. Boboy, CapEx. We're expecting CapEx of Converge to be halved this year to 12 billion from 22 billion last year. Is that because you already front-loaded the expenses and you're just waiting to monetize? Or is it because you really won't be expanding as much as we all brace for a slowdown? Or maybe you're looking at welcoming new investors?
It's really the first, Mimi. As you properly said, during the lockdowns, we took advantage and we rolled out faster than mm-hmm. we had originally planned. So the backbone is rolled out. We're operating from Cagayan up north and soon all the way to Zamboanga down south. So the rest of the CapEx really is more to build out into new cities mm-hmm. where we don't operate yet. And then there are some payments, you know, on a staggered payment basis for our submarine cable investments, you know, the Bifrost mm-hmm. and CH2X. So that's really the reason why a lumpy CapEx in the last 2 years was the domestic backbone, which is largely done. Mm-hmm. So now it's more getting into the other unserved areas as far as Converge is concerned.
How about M&As, Boboy? Any M&As in advanced stages in serious negotiations today?
None so far. Obviously, the founders are always open to look at those things, but we haven't seen anything interesting that, you know, could really be accretive to us in the near term. But we're still keeping an eye open for any opportunities, for sure.
And everyone's excited about Blast TV, the content platform that you guys are launching in June. What else can you tell us about that?
Well, it's a little bit different because, you know, traditional TV has always been what's known as linear. Mm-hmm. So you have cable TV or satellite TV where you have a fixed schedule. And then next came the streaming services, which are basically on demand. Mm-hmm. So Blast TV is really more of a streaming service. There would be regular schedules, but there is also the capacity to provide on-demand video. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it would be available across different platforms, you know, as basic as your browser. So that is something that we're looking forward to launch. You know, it would add value to our existing customers and you know, of course, in the future, add more revenues as the pay versions come out.
So will you be producing the content or partnering with content producers?
We're just partnering. We're not going to double in content.
All right. And what is the goal? That this, how much revenue do you expect will be coming from this venture? Maybe 5-10% really, of top line?
We haven't really gone to that point, Mimi. It will start as a freemium service. Mm-hmm. By the way, it is also something known as ad supported. So. Mm-hmm. It depends, you know, on how aggressively we get it into our customers and, you know, how many viewers there are and how well the partner can sell ads. So
all right.
Too early to say.
All right. Boboy, last question. Anything else that you're working on? What are you most excited about in the next 6 months?
Obviously, the prepaid service is something that we're very bullish on. In a soft launch, we've already reached 30,000 customers, and the traction is growing faster every day.
Okay.
There will be a a flanker postpaid brand, which should also allow us to bring better quality broadband to even more customers. That's on the consumer side of things. Blast TV is one of the first value-added services we're launching. Our enterprise business is doing very well. Our SME business, you know, I was listening to your interviews earlier. SMEs are growing very fast. We're doing like 46% growth there. Our wholesale business, where we sell to other service providers, is also quite strong, north of 30%. And finally, the core enterprise. Now, we have started our Singapore office. We have a license there. And we're really looking forward to monetize the submarine cable investments that we've made. Bifrost, the first submarine cable in the world to go from Singapore all the way to the US, and CH2X, you know, Hong Kong to Singapore, of course, Converge lands both of these. We're seeing quite strong demand. There will soon be, in the near term, you know, a problem with bandwidth across the Pacific, and we're looking to leverage that with Bifrost.
All right. Exciting times ahead. Very busy for you. Thank you so much, Boboy, for joining us today. We'll see you soon.
And thank you again. And good morning to everyone. See you again.
All right.